Hello everyone, my name is Ravi and this would be the second part of functions tutorial. And today I talk about data functions. So actually there are hundreds of functions in Excel and it can be overwhelming trying to match the right formula with the right kind of data analysis. But actually most useful functions don't have to be complicated. Today, I will take you through 15 simple functions that will improve your ability to analyze data and help you to work efficiently using Excel. So in this tutorial, I have opened up a separate sheet for each and every function that I am going to talk in this tutorial. Each function will have a sample data set, and I have highlighted the general format of the particular function. First up, the function we will look at is the concatenate function. The concatenate function is one of the easiest to learn but most powerful formulas when conducting data analysis, and this is used to combine text, numbers, dates and more from multiple cells into one. And this is an excellent function for creating API endpoints or stock keeping units and Java queries. I have already typed my formula here. I will just show you how it comes. First, I have to type equal sign and then I have to type the concatenate function and then open the bracket. And then I need to select cells that I want to combine. So first I select this one and then I have to insert a comma and the next cell. And then close the bracket and press enter. As you can see, it combines the contents inside these two cells. So if I expand this, we will see how it works. For the numbers, also the same thing. So if I just these two numbers are concatenated. So mind you, in here this is not the algebraic sum of these two numbers, rather it actually does glue these two numbers together. So that's what this concatenate does. So the general formula once again is equal, then concatenate, and within brackets select the cells that you want to combine. So that's about the concatenate function. And next we go to length function. So length function basically provide the number of characters in a given cell. Let's see how it works. And I have write the general formula here. It is equal sign, then length, and inside the brackets we have select the cells. So I will show you equal len and open brackets. Then you have to select the cell that you want to find out the length and then close the bracket, then press enter. As you can see, this shows that there are 25 characters in this cell. That's the length function. And then we can go to count a function. This function identifies whether a cell is empty or not. It's actually quite straightforward and very useful. I will show how it works, and the general formula is equal count a, then open brackets, and you have to specify the cell and then close the bracket. So I will show it here. Equal count a, open brackets, and I will select the particular cell and then close bracket, press enter. This one here indicates that there is something inside the cell. So if I expand this, you will see in cell A5, since there are nothing, it indicates as zero. So that's basically what the count a function does. And next thing we will talk about is base and network days function. So this day function is exactly what it implies. This function determines the number of calendar days between two dates. This is a useful tool for assessing the life cycle of products, contracts, and run rating revenue depending on the service length. And it's an essential function. The general form is equal sign days, then open bracket. First you have to select the end date, and then you have to select the start date. So keep that in mind. So here I have already typed the thing. Here you can see equal days, then open bracket. First you have to type the end date, and then you have to type the start date, and then press enter. And as you can see, from 2020 to 2021, since the same date, it has actually 365 days. So that's what the days function does. Then the network days function. This is slightly more robust and useful, and this actually determines the number of work days between two dates, as well as an option to account for holidays. It's actually quite useful for project management. So I have typed the network days function here. The important thing to keep in mind is that in the network days function, first you have to give the start date, then you have to give the end date, and within brackets you have to give the number of holidays. The main difference is this start date and end date has been interchanged compared to days function, and you can give the holidays also. So that's how the network days function works. And yeah, so the next function is the sum ifs function. This is one of the must know formulas for a data analyst. The common formula used is just sum, like this. But in this sum ifs function, the difference is you can take the sum according to multiple criteria. So that's the importance of sum ifs function. So the general formula is like this: equal sum ifs, and within brackets you have to keep the range, the criteria, and the sum range. I will explain about this. Here I have actually typed the formula. So here you can see equal sum ifs, then I have given the range of my prices, and then I have given the criteria, which means I want to find in this range, and then after the comma I have given the product. This actually what this function does is it goes through this product column. Since I have typed this widget 1, what it does is it goes through the products and find out where the widget 1s are. So we have a couple of widget 1s, and then it will take the sum of that corresponding prices. So as you can see, widget 1, here it's 28 and here it's 40. So the sum of the two is 68. So that's how the sum ifs function works. The next one is the average ifs function. So this is actually quite similar to the sum ifs function. The only difference is it calculates the average rather than the sum. So here in this example, also actually the previous same example, this here what happens is widget 1 price, it will take the prices, two prices, and take the average of the two. So here 28 plus 40, which is 68, and divided by 2, the average is 34. So that's what the average if function does. So actually the general format is similar to sum ifs function, which is equal average ifs, and within brackets select cell, criteria, and the average range. And then we come to VLOOKUP function. This function is one of the most useful and recognizable data analyst functions. So here in this example, I have given the general format of the function, which is equal VLOOKUP, and within brackets you have to give the lookup value, table array, and the column index number, and the range lookup within brackets. So I will show you how it works. First, I have given the my products and the prices in this example. By using this function, what I do is I will find out the relevant price for my product. So here I have typed the formula. I have given the widget and then the range that I need to consider to take my price, and the index number, which is 2, and the lookup. So what I want to do is I want to put the relevant price in front of my product. So what this function does is it go through this range and find out what my product is, and the corresponding price is appeared here. If I go to a different product, which is widget 4, price of that will appear here, and yeah, widget 2, 35. So likewise, that's how the VLOOKUP function works. So the next function is IFERROR function. Here I have actually used another function, which is the FIND function. So actually I will explain more about this in the next sheet, but for the moment, what this FIND function does is it go through a range and find a particular word is a word or a character is inside that range. So here what it does is it goes through the given cell and see whether this particular big word is there. Here I have searched for the capital BIG. Only the A4 cell contains that word. That's why it shows 1 here, and all the other cells shows an error. So in order to avoid that error, we use IFERROR function. Here, as you can see, I have searched for the simple BIG. So here I have the simple BIG, then I have here, here, and here. So that corresponding cells show 1 to indicate that the word that we are searching for is there, and the rest of the cells are just blanked. And yeah, what it does is it does not show the error. Instead, it will keep the cell as it is. So that's about the IFERROR function. Then we come to two important yeah, actually this FIND function is I talked about a little while before. So anyway, these two functions are actually powerful functions for isolating specific text within a data set. Both functions are quite similar, but there is a small difference between the two. So the general format is like this. For the FIND function, it's equal FIND, then within brackets you have text, and within text and within brackets the start number. And in the search function is also the same thing inside the bracket, only the keyword is the difference. Here I have used the FIND function to find this capital BIG word. So I have actually used the function for the entire thing. As you can see, only A4 has the capital BIG, which is why it shows 1. Why the other cells are blank is because I have used the IFERROR function. So that's about the FIND. and search function. So in here, what I have searched for is simple BIG. But here also, you can see it shows 1. That means this search function is not case sensitive. Even though I have the capital BIG, it indicates that the particular word is here. So the search function make the query a bit broader. So that is the main difference. Rather than that, the two functions are quite similar. So the next function we are going to look at is the COUNTIFS function. COUNTIFS function is actually easiest way to count the numbers of instances a dataset meets a set of criteria. The general format is like this, equal COUNTIFS and then within brackets range and then the criteria. So here I have applied the function equal COUNTIFS and then I have specified the range. Here this $A to $A means the entire A column, and I have given the criteria as this big widget one. So basically what this function does is it go through the entire range that I have specified and find out how many times the particular word that I am searching is appeared. So here the big widget one has appeared 3 times, 1, 2, and 3. So that's why it shows 3. So this is actually quite straightforward what the function does. So that's about the COUNTIFS function. And then we move to two functions, which are left function and the right function. These two are efficient and straightforward methods for extracting static data out of cells. So left will return the X number of characters from the beginning of the cell, while the right will return the X number of characters from the end of the cell. I will explain about that in a minute. So here I have given the general format of the formula. For the left, you have left and cell and the number. Then right, you have right and the same thing. So what this left function does is, it go through a particular, so in this example, it go through this particular cell, which is A2, and it takes 3 characters from the left. So here it takes this 919. That's what the left function does. And similarly, the right function does the same thing from the opposite direction. So here I have typed equal right A2, the same cell. And here I wanted 4 characters from the right end. So 4 characters from the right end. Here 5555. So that's what appears here. So all these 4 numbers, I have the same thing. That's about the left and right functions. Then we come to rank function. This is an ancient Excel function, but that doesn't downplay its effectiveness for data analysis. This allows you to quickly denote how values rank in a dataset in an ascending or descending order. I have given the general formula, which is equal rank, and then within brackets I have to select the cell and the range that I want to rank against and the order. So here I have applied the formula. So here, so rank, and then I have given the particular cell address and then the range that I want to rank against this number. And then the 0 here means I want the descending order. What it does is it search through this range and find out the rank of this value. So inside this range, the 19 will be the lowest or the sixth highest value. So the rank would be 6. And if we take 45, it will be the highest value inside the range. So it says the rank is 1. So that's about the rank function. And then we will move to minifs function. This function is actually very similar to the min function, and except it allows you to take minimum of a set of values and match your criteria as well. So here I have given the format of this function, which is equal minifs, and then within brackets I have to given range 1 and the criteria and the range 2. So I will explain this. So here I have applied the formula. I have first typed equal, then minifs, and then I have to give the range 1. Now first I have given the my price range, and then I have to give the criteria. My criteria is what the widget is, and then I have to give the second range, which is a particular widget that I want to find my price. So here in simple terms, what the function has done is it has gone through the products and searched for widget 1. So as you can see, we have a couple of times the widget 1, and then it will compare the corresponding prices and has taken the minimum out of the two. So here we have 28 and 40, and the minimum of the two is 28. So similarly, you can check about these three as well. So that's about the minifs function. And then I have the maxifs function. This is also the same as minifs function. The only difference is here it will take the maximum rather than the minimum. So general formula is again the same thing, equal maxifs, and within brackets you have to give the first range and criteria and the second range. So the behavior of this function is also the same. If I explain in simple terms, what it has done is search for widget 1, and we have two values and taken the maximum value out of the two. So that's about the maxifs function. And then finally we have our sumproduct function. So this is an excellent function to calculate average returns, price points and margins, and this multiplies one range of values by its corresponding row counterparts. So I have given the general formula here, which goes as equal sumproduct, and within brackets I have to give first range, comma, then second range and slash, and I have to select the cell. I have applied the function here, so you will see I have typed equal sumproduct, then I have given the price range, and then my quantity range, which is my second range, and the sum of the quantities. Again, I will tell you what has happened here. What it does is it multiplies each of the corresponding cells. So it multiplies 28 by 7, 30 by 8, and again 28 by 9, and likewise it has multiplied the two, the price and the quantity, and has taken the sum of the two, and then it has divided that by the total quantity to find out the average selling price. So that's what has happened in this function here. So those are the 15 functions that I promised you to talk about in this tutorial. And next we will look at a couple of other things related to functions. Now we will look at the function library. This is actually a great place to explore functions in Excel. What we have to do is, first I have to select the cell that I want to apply a particular function, and then I have to click the formulas tab, and in the function library group I have to select the function category that I want. Here in this example I will just demonstrate that network days function which we did earlier. So what I have to do is, I have to go to the date and time, and within this drop down menu I can find this the same function here. So when I click on this, it will pop up this particular dialog box. Here you can see, you may be familiar with this now. So we have to select the start date, end date and holidays like we did in previous function. So the start date will be the date ordered, and then I have to select the end date, which is the date received. I can use the holidays as well, so I will just put 3 here, and you can see the result is appeared here, and the same thing you can see here as well. So the result will be result of this function would be 262, and then I have to press the OK, and the result will appear here. So that's how we can use function library to quickly use our functions. Next, I would like to talk about the name range and formulas. In everyday life, names are widely used to refer to people or objects or geographical locations. So similarly, in Excel, you can give a human readable name to a single cell or a range of cells and refer to those cells by name rather than by reference. So Excel has two types of names. First one is a defined name, a name that refers to a single cell or range of cells or constant value or a formula. For example, when you define a name for a range of cells, it's called a name range or defined range. And the next type is table name, a name of an Excel table that is created automatically when you insert a table in a worksheet. So those are the two Excel name types. And now I want to show you how to type a name in the name box. The name box in Excel is the fastest way to create a named range. So first I have to select the cells that I want to name. So I will here select this range that I want to name the these cells. So then I have to type a suitable name in my name box. So I will give fruits as the name, and then simply press enter, and now it will appear as my name for this range. So if I select this, you can see it says fruits. So that's how you can name a particular range using the name box. Here I will show an example of a use. So I have a named my items as fruits, and then I will give a name sales for my values, and then I will give a name for my the particular fruit as well. So I will explain more about this in a minute. So just for the moment I will name this as item. Okay, so here what I have done is, I have used my sum if function to find out the total number of sales from apples. So here I have typed the formula separately to show you. Now I will show you how to implement the same function without typing all these ranges. Rather, I can use my range names and this formula or cell names. So I will type equal sum if and then within brackets. Rather than this range, I will simply type fruits and then the criteria, which is my apples. So the name I gave was item, and then the sum range, which is sales. That was the name I gave for my sum range. If I enter this, you will get the same answer. So that's how you can use this names in Excel to easily implement functions. And finally, I'm going to talk about how to create a name by using the name define option in Excel. So here I have a sample. I will go through the steps. First, I have to select the cells that I want to give a name, and then go to the formulas tab, and I have to click this define name button, and it will open this dialog box, and here I can just type the name that I want to give. So I will use fruits, the same thing. You can see in the scope drop down we have to set the name scope. In here actually it doesn't matter, the default one is workbook, and then here you have to see whether this reference is correctly mentioned. So here in this case it's okay, and then finally I have to click OK to save the changes and close the dialog box. So now you can see I have successfully named my this particular range as fruits. So that's another way to create a name by using a define name option. So those are the things that I wanted to cover in this functions part 2 tutorial. So it actually became a bit lengthy video, but anyway, I hope you got a good understanding about these functions. And I will see you again in another tutorial. Thank you very much.